Let us begin the virtual meeting on the Seed Grows Up, Volume 1.
Okay.
Yesterday is a history. Tomorrow is a mystery. Today is a story. And the story of how the seed of the Society of J&J grew up, bloomed, and flourished over the years. In the heart of a seed, buried deep, so deep, a little sapling lay fast asleep. Wake, said the sunshine, and sprout to the light. Wake, said the voice of the raindrops bright. The little plant heard, and it rose to see what the wonderful outside world might be. The extraordinary J&J seed grew up and continues to grow up under the sunshine of God Almighty, planted and fostered by our founder, Reverend Father Matthias Wolff, growing up strong and high through the nurturings of hundreds of J&J sisters, bearing fruits hundredfold for the past 200 years. A very good morning, good afternoon, and good evening to all. Today's program is as follows: opening prayer, welcome, releasing of the book, The Seed Grows Up, Volume 1, presentation, The Seed Grows Up, Volume 1, plenary session, vote of thanks, and closing prayer. I now invite Sister Jayashila Koratigiri to lead the opening prayer.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Dear sisters, big things often have small beginnings, together in God's word and love. Let us boldly go to grow and sow Christ's kingdom, to plant a seed, watch it and grow it. It will go so much further than we will ever know and visualize it. And whether harsh or kind, its power will be heard. The roots below the earth claim no rewards for making the branches fruitful. And whether its fruit will bring joy or distress, you are the one who will endure or bless. The one who plants trees, knowing that he will never sit in their shade, has at least started to understand the meaning of life. So, let us pray that we will take care of the sowing. God will take care of the growing. May the Lord work in us to grow us into what the Lord wants us to do before a seed to achieve its greatest express. It must come completely undone. The shell cracks, its inside come out, and everything changes. To someone who doesn't understand growth, it would look like complete destruction. Lord, help us to surrender our dreams and our destinations to you. Thy will be done. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Thank you, Sister Jayashila, for imploring God's blessings to rain upon us, and very especially during this session. On behalf of the congregational team, leadership team, and the bicentenary committee members, I, Sister Marie Shamla Eri, deem it as a great privilege to welcome you all, dear sisters, to this webinar on the Seed Grows Up, Volume 1. I am sure all of you have read through it. Beautifully designed second edition of the book written by Sister Serapin Gomez in 1957. As a big JMJ family, we must rejoice and celebrate the history of JMJ, which is full of challenges, blessings, encounters, and benedictions. On this most momentous occasion, I warmly and wholeheartedly welcome each one of you to this virtual platform to listen to our history, to exchange experiences and inspire one another to appreciate the past with a grateful heart as we live the present with courage and move into the future with hope. At the outset, I extend a cordial welcome to Reverend Sister Anacleta Boredi, the guest speaker for today. A warm welcome to our esteemed and dynamic leadership team members and all the participants for this touchscreen digital platform. Now we have online release of The Seed Grows Up, Volume 1. We are truly delighted to note that during the bicentenary year of our dear society, JMJ, our General Council had taken the responsibility of editing and printing the second edition of The Seed Grows Up, Volumes 1, 2, and 3. During this month, we have been inspired to read Volume 1. The Seed Grows Up book, first volume, was reprinted a month ago, and it is in our hands during this month. We thank and place on record the contribution of Sister Anthony Mary Dasari and Council, Bangalore Province, for typing the content from the original book and printing it by Seva Southern Brothers. We appreciate Sister Mary Karakakunal, Sister Vijaya Udumala, the General Council, and Sister Annette Rodriguez, the Secretary, for editing and proofreading the manuscript, and Mr. Gopi B for designing the cover pages. On this significant and historical event, it is my pleasure to invite our Superior General, Reverend Sister Innamma Yerwa, to release the soft copy of The Seed Grows Up, Volume 1. Amidst applause from the virtual audience.
Thank you, dear sisters, for this beautiful opportunity of releasing Seed Grows Up, the Volume 1. As Sister Samala has already mentioned the names responsible for this stupendous work, I congratulate each one of them for their hard work and commitment, and I deem it a great honor to release the Volume 1, Seed Grows Up. It was the history of our pioneers, and now we have made it the history of each one of us, that we grow like that of the seed and become more and more vibrant in facing the challenges of today's world. Thank you.
Thank you, Sister Innamma. Now we have presentation on the Seed Grows Up Volume 1. I invite Sister Rudeya Arogya Swami to introduce and welcome today's resource person, Sister Anakleta Goreddy.
Dear sisters, our life is a gift from God, and what we do with this life is our gift to God. Today, I deem it a privilege to welcome our dear sister Anakleta, who is gifted and multi-talented person in many ways and many years in the congregation of Jesus, Mary and Joseph. Sister Anakleta Goreddy hails from a traditional Catholic village, Peddakottala, in Kurnool district of Andhra Pradesh. In the order of birth, she is the youngest, like the Benjamin, of 7 children born to her beloved parents. Entering the society in 1964, she made her temporary profession in 1967. Having done BCom degree, she served as clerk in the school office at Guntur as community procurator for 11 years and as an Indian province procurator at J&J Provincialate Samajgura, Hyderabad for 7 years. She completed MCom with gold medal in 1987. Sister Anakleta served for 12 years as provincial counselor of newly established Bangalore province and as general counselor for 2 terms in the Netherlands. She was superior of St. Stanislaus Convent, Bangalore for 3 years and worked in Nepal at Jesuit Refugee Service. Presently, she is the superior of J&J Convent, Palamner, and actively engaged in social service activities. The meaning of life is to find gift. Find your gift. The purpose of life is to give it away, said Pablo Picasso. Sister Anakleta is truly blessed with great experiences in life as a J&J and being bestowed with wisdom and knowledge by her visits to different countries and a rich lived-in experiences with people from different walks of life. To her credit, she served the congregation of J&J in various capacities as an effective finance manager, as provincial and general counselor. She lived a value-based life with conviction and determination, excelling in every ministry entrusted to her by the congregation. All through her 57 years of life as a consecrated religious, today she stands out as an embodiment of principles and values, being available to any mission she is called to embrace. Having said this, now it's my honor to invite our guest speaker, Reverend Sister Anakleta Goreddy, to present the highlights of The Seed Grows Up, Volume 1, The History of the Society of Jesus, Mary, Joseph, from its foundation in 1922 to 1940, authored by Sister Seraphim Gomez in 1957. Dear Sister Anakleta, I request you to take over the session. Over to you, Sister Anakleta. Thank you.
Yeah. What the wonderful words you have expressed about me. And for the good introduction that has been given, thank you. And now we go to the presentation of the Seed Grows Up. So can I proceed now? Sister Christy?
Yes, sister. Yes, sister.
Okay. Good evening, sisters, once again, and welcome to all of you for this sharing of the Seed Grows Up, Volume 1. Mm-hmm. Okay, now we see how the seed has germinated and putting on leaves and growing upwards. So is the Society of Jesus, Mary, Joseph, and now the Congregation of Jesus, Mary, Joseph is growing up like this. So now we go into the historical facts of the founding of the congregation. In the Middle Ages, the Low Countries called Netherlands, Belgium, and Luxembourg are the coastal region of Northwest Europe, and they have been dotted with convents and monasteries from the 8th century onwards. There arose in such a Catholic atmosphere, at the end of the 16th century, Protestantism came into power and caused the disappearance of convents. Priests went in disguise to say mass and administer the sacraments in secret in private houses. The fidelity and spirit of sacrifices of the Catholics made them persevere in their faith. And then you would have heard in the previous slide that the priests went in disguise and the churches disappeared and the converts disappeared. Those who had been to Amsterdam would remember there was one church called Papagai, that is a parrot. So where inside, outside it is nothing to be visible, but deep inside if you go, there was a church. So in 1815, please go back to the previous slide. Christy, please go back to the previous slide. In 1815, Belgium and Netherlands were united under King William I, a prince of the House of Orange. In the constitution of that year, the principle of freedom of religion made education a monopoly of the state. So you can remember the influence of Protestantism coming into education field. So we go into the next one. In such circumstances, Catholic parents preferred to keep their children away from school as they were poor on the whole. At an early age, the children had to work in factories and in the fields. Only the well-to-do could send their children abroad to a Catholic boarding school. In government circles, the anti-Catholic disposition remained. They saw to it that there were no convents. So today also in our own world now, in our present situation, in India also we are going through the same situation. We could say that. We go next. So on April 15th, 1802, Father Wolf was ordained a priest. He worked as parish priest in Oseldingen, De Kerk, Dudelingen, and professor in Metz. The year 1814 is a turning point with the happy news of restoration of Society of Jesus all over the world. His strong desire to be a Jesuit was made possible on 13th February 1815 when he entered the Society of Jesus at the age of 36. While Wolf makes his appearance in the Netherlands in 1816, destined to do great things. At the request of Dutch missions, Father Wolf and Father De Haast arrived in Culemborg, which was now to be the scene of Father Wolf's activity. At the end of the 18th century, Catholicism was in a deplorable state because of the absence of powerful spiritual in those circumstances, the rise of Catholicism. An important event for the rise of Catholicism in the Dutch mission was the foundation of a seminary which came into being at Culemborg in 1818. On account of all his experiences in the care of souls, Father Wolf became more and more convinced that religious teaching was of paramount importance also for girls. So he decided to give it all his strength and attention. Everything had, however, to be done in secret. So, beginning of the foundation, while praying for light, something happened that he considered a sign from heaven. Two young girls, penitents of his, revealed to him their desire to devote their lives to God in the religious state. They were Maria Stiptus, aged 19, and Sophia Miltner, 17. In them, he saw the first sisters of the congregation. And a short time later, a third presented herself, Labuna van Elk. A thorough religious training was necessary for them, but where? There were no convents in northern Netherlands. Father Wolf wished to found a contemplative, active congregation. He had heard a great deal about the Sisters of Our Lady, whose mother house was at Namur in Ghent. This congregation was founded in 1806 by Blessed Julie Billiard. Self-sanctification and religious teaching to girls were its specific aims. That is why Father Wolf thought it the ideal model for his future congregation. He applied to the Superior General in Namur, Mother Joseph Blind de Borden, who gladly admitted the young candidates into the Ghent convent for their temporary stay. So then, okay, the plans also to send them for training to Ghent, but how to find means for it? Father Wolf, however, had financial difficulties, and his trust in God's providence had never let him down. He had been miraculously helped by St. Anthony in 1821 when he needed 1,500 Belgian francs for board and lodging of his sisters at Namur, while he did not have a penny with him. A mysterious impulse urged him to go to Utrecht. Here, a gentleman unknown to him told him that he was going to Namur and asked Father Wolf if he wanted money. His offer was gratefully accepted, and a short time afterwards, the sisters sent a message to Father Wolf that an unknown gentleman had paid the debt. What a marvelous providence of God. The journey to Ghent was undertaken by these three candidates on 7th November 1819, the feast of St. Willibrord. St. Willibrord is the saint of Netherlands. On 9th November, the candidates began their novitiate and adopted their religious names. Maria Stiptus as Matthias Stiptus, Sophia Miltner as Rosalie, and Labuna van Elk kept her Christian name. On November 13, our Wolf was back at Culemborg. This event did not remain a secret. Much was talked about and discussed. A short time later, four more candidates presented themselves and joined the little group at Ghent. Johanna de Brood, that is St. Antonia, she died at Ghent in May 1822 after 6 months of novitiate. In her deathbed, she was allowed to make her vows. How fortunate she was. Father Wolf called her the first advocate of the congregation in heaven. Father Wolf selected three of the novices, Sister Mattia, Rosalie, and Boniface. So Father Wolf selected three of the novices, Sisters Mathia, Rosalie, and Boniface, who were capable to be superiors or teachers, and requested the Superior General to allow them to spend some time in Mother House at Namo. Sister Rosalie was allowed to copy the rules of the congregation of the Sisters of Our Lady. Later on, these rules were adopted by Father Wolf for his new congregation with hardly any change. For 20 years, the institute was governed according to these rules. In the meantime, Father Wolf has been elevated. After the Vice Provincial Father Godinot had made visitation, he appointed Father Wolf as a Superior in General of the Jesuits in the three stations of Amsterdam, Nijmegen, and Culemborg. This appointment may be considered as a sign of trust and encouragement as the Father's will. Father Wolf spoke of his intention to found a congregation for women. Meanwhile, three more candidates presented themselves in the course of 1822. Father Wolf did not want to wait any longer before founding his new congregation. So he called back from Namur Sisters Mathia, Cunera, and Lubina. After fervent prayer, Father Wolf now took the important decision and founded the congregation by the name of Pedagogic Retiari. It means Christian education on 29th July 1822. Prudent as Father Wolf was, he gave the name of Christian education, which did not directly refer to a convent or a community, to the outer world. By that name, the congregation was known for a long time. The title, Sisters of the Blessed Virgin Mary, by which the congregation was also known from the first, will have been derived from that of Sisters of Notre Dame of Namur, from which they took the rules and convent life. French names and words were to continue in the congregation till 1946. The second name, Society of Jesus Mary Joseph, meant for the intimacy of the religious community. The founder embodied the spirit that was to inspire the sisters. As companions of Jesus, Mary, Joseph, living in the seclusion of Nazareth, the sisters should specially acquire the virtues of obedience, simplicity, and charity. On his visits to Namur and Kent, Father Wolf very frequently referred to the virtue of obedience, which was the solid basis laid down by St. Ignatius for his order. It may be looked on as his characteristic trait. The first community. After their stay in Belgium, the sisters settled down in Utrecht in the house of Maria van Werkhoven. The community consisted of Sister Mathia Stichter as superior, Cunera Stapperhoff, Ignatia van Werkhoven, Antonio Dubios, and Martha Pipers. So the first rules, on 10th June 1823, the Christian education consists of provision from the Archbishop of Utrecht, G. van Nooy, and on 11th from J. Kamer, Archpriest and successor of J. van Banning. The rules which were handed over together with a request for approbation consisted only of the principal precepts in 11 short articles. The article 1 contained principal aim of the institute, namely education of the poor. The rules and directions of the Sisters of Namur were meant for the community, which were more in detail with very few changes made by Father Wolf. According to these rules, the first sisters had been formed. Moreover, they breathed Jesuit spirit. An original copy of the 1822 rules in manuscript bound in red leather is among the Marienburg archives. It is kept there as precious document. Now the archives is shifted to St. Agatha, a common archives for all religious of Netherlands. This is the latest development. Its full title is Rules and Directions of the Sisters of the Blessed Virgin Mary or Christian Education or the Society of Jesus Mary Joseph. In 26 chapters, it deals with the government, the spirit, and the aim of the Institute, life under vows and the virtues, the various obligations, life of prayer, education, etc. Here, important note, the obligatory prayers were an hour's meditation in the morning and half an hour in the evening. And before chapter 24, Father Wolf wrote next to a pasted in picture of St. Francis Xavier, everyone should be willing to go wherever obedience calls, even to America and the Indies. He who is obedient will always be victorious and be blessed. The missionary thought was already vivid in the founder. At the end of the rules and directions, Father Wolf writes, all of you who will ever be called to this Institute of the Sisters of the Blessed Virgin Mary or Christian Education or the Society of Jesus Mary Joseph, thank God for this great benefit and observe the rules of this Institute strictly with the help of God. Try to reach perfection with all your might and persevere in this until your eternal bliss. Amen. On the feast of St. Ignatius Loyola, 1822, pray for me, was in our young Wolf Archpriest. That is Matthias Wolf, Roman Catholic priest. Amos put the first foundation. A lot of deliberation went on where to found the first school with the first community and where to find the means for its upkeep. Influential friends and counselors were to help him again. Among them was the well-known Mr. Lesage ten Broek, dissuaded Father Wolf from choosing Culemborg for his school, since in this town the Jesuits had a bad name in government circles. Amersfoort was to be preferred as more suitable. Father Radlebeek, the parish priest of Utrecht, and Mr. J. Marsh gave them powerful help, the latter especially financially. The small group of progressive Catholics of those days, of whom Lasagna was the soul, took particular interest in the new foundation. The same must be said of Father G. Vermilion, parish priest of Soli Deo at Amersfoort. On June 24, 1823, a house of the so-called wall houses on June 24, 1823, a house of the so-called wall houses was hired at Amersfoort in the name of Miss Van Werkhoven for a period of 6 years for 175 guilders a year. Then the first charity school was at once opened. From September 1823, the convent hidden among wall houses at Amersfoort number 7 religious. And since 1828, the convent at Amersfoort became the mother house. Sister Mathia became the superior general with the title of Mother Superior.
Father Wolf was satisfied with the beginning. He was faithful in visiting his spiritual children, often in disguise, because it would be too dangerous to intimate that there was something like a convent to the wall houses. The young women for the outer world were merely lay people who maintained a school. It was a happy day for the founder when 8 nuns took their religious vows for 1 year on June 8, 1824. He himself had prepared everything for it in the tiny chapel. It must have been a day of glory for him. The legalization of the school. To ensure the continuation of the institute as per government rules, a legal acknowledgement was necessary. This had, of course, to be called by a name that could not arouse suspicion. Therefore, the Association of Van Werkhoven was founded to act as a school board and represent the institute in law. On November 13, 1824, it was founded by a notarial act, which means the judicial act. They were enthusiastically inspired and devoted to their new work. A center of piety and apostolate, the convent was to be hidden among the fortresses of the old town. Sisters Rosalie and Boniface lived a long life and died in 1886 and in 1887 in St. Evan's. They were a link with the origin of the congregation and the living examples of the unweakened spirit. First boarding school. In December 1824, a boarding school began with 3 girls from leading Utrecht families. In the magazine, The God's Dreams Frame, The Friend of Religion, Lesage had enthusiastically announced the foundation of the boarding school and promoted it vigorously. This institute, to which many have been looking forward, has been opened under the name of Van Werkhoven and Co. The boarding school flourished. They were from well-to-do families of Amsterdam, Utrecht, and elsewhere. Father Wolf encouraged the sisters and the girls at his regular visits. Ever cheerful and humorous, he managed always to make his visits and instructions a happy event. At the same time, he tried to lay a solid foundation for the upbuilding of his religious institute. The first growth. In the tiny village of Engelen near Den Bosch, Sir James Van Hoff, the Norbertine, was the parish priest from 1820 to 1841. He wrote to Father Wolf, who was quick to accept the offer, and sent sisters Boniface and Antonia in October 1826. So the boarding school building. From the beginning, it had been the founder's intention to see to the education of girls also from the upper classes. Fathers De Haak and Father Wolf set off to begin again, and a necessary capital was collected. In the spring of 1828, began the construction and completed by February 1829. The big house became the pride of England. In 3 more places, schools and sewing classes were opened in about 1830, namely at Flyman, Den Bosch, and Gertruderberg. On account of the war troubles in Belgium and lack of means, Gertruderberg was stopped. The second establishment. In 1829, a second batch is the branch establishment was opened at Nijmegen. This town had an old Jesuit station. The beginning was primitive and poor. 3 sisters were moved from Engelen to a house in Oude Varkensmarkt, that means old pig market, the location. The ground floor was the school, and the sisters occupied the first floor. Very quietly and in hiding, they began their work. Withdrawal of Father Wolf. In the first period of history, the year 1830 may be looked upon as a glorious year. There were 4 convents and 19 members. Father Wolf had done his utmost to lay a strong foundation for the religious life of his sisters. His superiors, being convinced that the congregation was firmly established, asked Father Wolf to withdraw, as it is not the task of, according to the constitutions of Jesuits. He did so completely in obedience. But in the meantime, the dark clouds gathered in Amersfoort. Over the mother house in Amersfoort, dark clouds were gathering in 1831, not by the threats from outside world, but from within, because of the conduct of the superior general. She did well under the guidance of Father Wolf. She was only 28 when she was charged with the general government of the congregation. She was not strong enough in her vocation and was unable to combine apostolic and prayer life. Added to this, she was more concerned about material interests and herself. She lived more a worldly life as a layperson. She never visited them or sent any letters. The apostolic spirit, characteristic of the congregation, no longer existed. At that time, the sisters did not wear yet any religious habit. An old document states that 24 were sent back to Colombo and 9 from England. She hardly had any contact with the other 3 convents. A few times, Mother Mathia was warned by the 2 sisters who were with her at Namur. For a long time, the conduct of the superior general remained a secret from the ecclesiastical authorities and Father Wolf. The other sisters at Amersfoort and other communities stuck to their simple religious way of living. Towards the end of the year, in the meantime, Monsignor Antonisi, the internuncio, received several favors for the congregation from His Holiness the Pope. In a cheerful letter dated 20th July 1839, Father Wolf made known these to the Superior General. Towards the end of that year, the ecclesiastical authorities were informed more fully of the spirit that animated the Superior General. Sister Boniface, who was called to Amersfoort in the beginning of 1840 by the Superior General for a short stay, has seen the worldly conduct of Mother Mathia and decided to inform Father Wolf, who was in Nijmegen. He was deeply disappointed to hear of the sad state of affairs. 2 sisters, Agnes and Berkmans, were given the task of informing the Superior General of the decision of the ecclesiastical authorities that Mathia should leave the congregation. Terribly frightened, she besought to be allowed to stay. She begged that she would live a scanty way of life, but the decision was not withdrawn. Some difficult months followed. The association of Van Verhoeven and Co. was dissolved, and Maria, in June of the same year, left to her hometown, Culemborg, at the age of 40. Her resignation was made known to the Superior General, Superior at Engelen, and not to Father Wolf. In the biography of Father Wolf, her one book wrote, "Needless to say, in voices of sorrow, the founder of the congregation was submerged on hearing the tidings. He calls it the darkest page in Father Wolf's life." Father Wolf's intervention. In these circumstances, Father Wolf's superiors gave him permission to take up the guidance of the congregation again. Immediate action was necessary. The first thing was to appoint a superior able to give guidance to the existing convents. Mother Clara Landman was appointed as provisional superior general by Father Wolf. From March 1st, 1840 onwards, England became the principal seat of the congregation, and from that time, this was the mother house. In her capacity, Mother Clara visited the convents of Nijmegen and Zevenbergen, where the members professed their faithfulness to Father Wolf and the mother house. After the dismissal of Mattia, there were only 5 sisters left in Amersfoort who had not renewed their vows on February 2nd, 1840. In an important letter to the nuncio, those in Amersfoort wrote that they called themselves as sures emeritus de Notre Dame and refused to comply with the regulations of Father Wolf, that is, sisters emeritus of Notre Dame congregation, that is the meaning of that. So in 1840, Father Wolf came to preside over the final election of superior general. Mother Clara was elected unanimously. Her assistant Christina Goodhart had to resign in the same year due to ill health, and Sister Adriana Pipers replaced her. At Engelen, a new future was opening for congregation. For the congregation of JMJ. In June 1840, 4 candidates joined the society. Father Wolf asked for a new approbation from Internuncio and the Nuncio of the Apostolic See to the Dutch court. On 5th December, the answer came, which gave great joy. This remarkable document is a convincing proof of the Society of JMJ that had been approved of by the high ecclesiastical authorities in the Netherlands as early as in the year 1823. In those days, there were no dioceses as yet because of the rise of Protestantism. The Society of Women for Education. Father Wolf's and Mother Clara's intention was to establish the congregation on a solid basis. An important fact was in 1842, with the formation of the corporate body, Society of Women for Education. By this title, the congregation would henceforward act in all civil and legal matters. On September 30, the Memorandum of Association was passed, and the regulations have remained operative ever since. The congregation began a new flourishing period. 2 more convents were founded, one in Den Bosch, and that is in Kerkstraat and Waalwijk. Here comes Monsignor Suysen and the congregation. In 1842, Monsignor Suysen was appointed as Bishop of Hera, which was added to the vicariate of Den Bosch. For his congregation of Sisters of Charity, Father Suysen wrote a rule or constitutions and sent them to Rome in 1838. After repeated attempts, the constitutions were approved on 29th March 1844. He sent these constitutions and rules of his congregation to Father Wolf, which was to be adopted with some additions and alterations. In great fidelity to the founder's spirit, the sisters accepted them in full submission. On 7th January 1845, Monsignor sent the approved constitutions with another letter in which he reminds that henceforth there is no other authority in the congregation but that derived from the constitutions. So we can say from here a little bit about the Suysen's thinking that he would be the founder of the congregation. So that was the intention inferred from his acting on sending his constitutions. A momentous day, 22nd January 1845 was a momentous day in the history of the congregation. Father Wolf came to England as a delegate of Monsignor Schweitzer. You can see the departure from being called as the founder, now he is called as a delegate of the Monsignor Schweitzer. In order to proclaim the constitutions, to take the vows of the sisters, which would be perpetual, and to preside over the election of the central government. The sisters made their perpetual vows only in 1845. Until then, they made vows only annually. He then read out the articles of the constitutions one by one with the necessary comments and uttered a fervent wish that the papal approbation might soon be required. The new central government was elected with Sister Lantman as superior general, Sister Adriana Pipers, first assistant, Maria Bausink, second assistant, and Antonio Dubius, third assistant. At the end of this report, Father Wolf writes, "May God grant that the approbation of the Pope may now follow. Then my desire will be fulfilled, and I shall be able to say with Simeon, 'Now let thy servant go in peace,' as we pray in the night prayer." So efforts for papal approval and unification of society changed with Amersfoort. In his great zeal, Father Wolf wished to speed up the papal approbation immediately. He supposed that the bishop himself had sent the necessary documents for the application to Rome. But this was a mistake. On 5th February 1845, Father Wolf wrote to Bishop about the special indulgences he obtained for the sisters, and these would be useful to speed up the approbation from Rome. But on 9th February, a callous reply from Bishop raised doubts about his intentions. He had not sent the documents to Rome. Throughout 1845, nothing has been heard from Rome. While this was going on, Father Wolf had a desire to unify England and Amersfoort. Several letters went back and forth between Monsignor Ferrari, Monsignor Schweitzer, without success. For a year, the matter was left. When the matter was discussed with Mother Clara, she answered that if it is Monsignor Ferrari's wish, we shall be content with it, but not to be subordinate to Amersfoort. Finally, the proposal for union came to an end with a letter of Monsignor Schweitzer dated 24th July 1847. Finally, the proposal for Monsignor Schweitzer thought differently. Since he had recently written new constitutions for the congregation of England, and he thought he had founded it anew by his powerful help. So the religious habit, symbols and titles. The year 1846 was also remarkable for the congregation of JFJ, as the sisters took a religious habit of their own. Until then, they were in black dresses. On November 3rd, Monsignor Schweitzer himself came for this, taking up the habit, or as it was called, putting on the veil. The gold cross with the two hearts of Jesus and Mary, the monogram of IHS and Society JMJ was to be the permanent distinction of the Sisters of Society JMJ, together with the gold ring with the image of Christ crucified, which is handed to them at the time of profession. On that day, the titles were determined. Superior General would henceforth be called Reverend Superior. The first assistant would be a sister assistant, and the superiors of the convents to be addressed as Reverend Mothers. Later on, the title of the Superior General was changed to Mother Superior, and other assistants as Mother, so the novice and postulant mistresses. The influence of French culture was very strong in the Netherlands. Since the 18th century, the knowledge and use of French were part of good breeding. So if you know French, you are a good breeding. Papal approbation. After his return from Rome, Bishop Schweitzer sent all the documents to Rome on 20th March 1855. Much earlier to this, Father Wolf had contacted Cardinal Frassoni, with whom he had very good contacts about the papal approbation of the constitutions. On 10th May, Cardinal Frassoni wrote that the letters with the constitutions had been received and that it would be dealt with as early as possible. On 25th July 1855, Archbishop Schweitzer informed of the good news of the papal approbation of the constitutions. When Father Wolf heard of it, he was beside himself with great joy. Writes Father Van Hook, making a note of the happy event, he adds in Latin, "Thanks be to God, thanks to the Blessed Virgin Mary, and to St. Anthony," because it was Tuesday. "Thanks to our Holy Father, all the saints, St. Michael, and all the angels. May God bless us." Father Wolf informed of his journal about the approbation. The latter replied that may God who began this work continue his blessings. It looked as if this joy gave renewed strength to the old priest. He traveled to Utrecht, Nijmegen, and Engelen, where the sisters from other convents had gathered. And this was his last visit. That was in 1855. It is worthwhile throwing a light on the figure of Father Wolf. So we can say up to number 30, we could say that is the beginnings of the endurance and the hardships that Father endured to found the Congregation of Society of JMJ. Now we can go into detail about the person of Father Wolf. It is worthwhile throwing light on the figure of Father Wolf. He is universally acknowledged as one of the leaders of the Catholic revival in the Northern Netherlands. People bear witness to his regular instructions at holy masses, benedictions, catechism classes for children, attracting them with little presents, etc. He was very much frequented in confessional, so much so he told the faithful, "Do not ask me when I am hearing confessions." He took the first initiative for the first retreat for the priests. In 1837, some 50 priests from neighborhood attended the retreat. On closing day of the retreat, people in large numbers came rushing in. When the large crowds came, he had to preach in the fields. Notwithstanding his care for souls, he was keenly interested in the development of his congregation. He helped them by his words, spiritual instructions, and the retreats. Father Wolf left a respectable number of thick notebooks in which he had jotted down completely worked out instructions, sermons, meditations written in his fine handwriting, not only for the people, but for the sisters of his congregation. Besides a number of meditations on the glorious qualities of our Lord Jesus Christ, Our Lady, and Saint Joseph, also the so-called maxims were written. These were written down in French in 5 booklets and were printed only after his death. The second part of maxims was written in Dutch. These maxims especially are important for the knowledge of Father Wolf's spirituality. The first part clearly shows affinity with the spiritual exercises of St. Ignatius. For the second part, beginning with the rule 86, he made use of the work of Father J.J. Surin S.J., which was largely adapted from Imitation of Christ. In this work, he judged what is necessary for his sisters, namely, how to live a deeply interior life by the practice of humility, which in itself is the basis of obedience, the spirit of mortification and detachment, the spirit of prayer and surrender to God's work in the soul. In the maxims, the sisters might dig gold, but pure gold is to be found there. And it is one of the merits of Rector Deckers. He was the rector of Mother House in later years. Some fragments of maxims. Rule 24 gives a definition of discernment of spirits according to St. Ignatius' doctrine. Rules 28 and 29 describe the qualities of perfect obedience. As a true son of St. Ignatius, he stressed this virtue. It was also one of the characteristics of our congregation. At the end of the lengthy treatise, he summarizes everything in a pithy, that is an expressive enumeration. Obedience of the deed, obedience of the will, obedience of the intellect, obedience in office, obedience of place, obedience of dress, obedience in big matters, mute and blind obedience, obedience of every minute, obedience forever, obedience leading to life eternal. Amen. May perfect obedience be. Father Wolf had great devotion to the Sacred Heart and love for Our Lady. He liked to see the congregation as one large family under the protection of the ideal family of all times, Jesus, Mary, Joseph. In it, he had occasion to speak of the virtues that should be practiced, namely simplicity, charity, humility, and obedience. He liked to preach the 8 days retreat for his sisters at England based on spiritual exercises of St. Ignatius until his ripe old age when he could not do so. It became a tradition in the congregation that all the sisters of JMJ have an yearly opportunity of following an Ignatian retreat. This tradition has never been deviated from. Monsignor Swanson had asked Father Wolf to preach retreats for the congregation of his sisters, for the sisters of his congregation. Father Wolf was an acknowledged leader of the spiritual life for priests and religious, not only in the Netherlands, but also in Belgium and Germany. So Father Wolf back at Culemborg, miraculous cure. After the death of Father De Haast, Father Wolf was asked another sacrifice through his provincial, though he did not want to ask him to move to Culemborg. With his customary humor, Father Wolf answered, "How does a donkey answer? Eager, because it cannot read. And I can read, and so I say, yeah," which means yes. When in spring 1849, Mother Clara visited Father Wolf, she found him not too well and was almost at the point of death. But he recovered miraculously, which Father Wolf prized to one of his friends in Dieppe. Three doctors had been called, and he heard them say that he may last for a quarter of an hour. But he opened his eyes and looked at the statue of Our Lady and said in a weak voice, "Mother of God, if you think I can still do any good, be my intercessor with your son." He hardly finished his prayer when one of the doctors felt my pulse, saying, "He is saved." Father Wolf informed Mother Clara of his cure in a cheerful letter. "Well then, dear nuns, let us do much good and offer our hearts daily to God. Nay, every hour, every minute, every second, every moment, He loves us." A new foundation in Culemborg. In connection with his golden jubilee of his ordination, Father Wolf did everything possible to get his congregation to Culemborg. After negotiations with the parish priests and the civil authorities of Culemborg, reached an agreement in November 1851, despite financial constraints. Father Wolf celebrated his golden jubilee on 25th April 1852 with a great splendor, and he expressed his great joy at the present the congregation offered him of the new convent in his parish. The convent was established on 6th May 1852, and St. Matthias was to be its patron saint. So the new central government was formed again. In 1851, a new central government has to be elected as the time of office had expired. Mother Clara Lantman and Mother Adriana Pipers were re-elected as Superior General and First Assistant. The death of Father Wolf. In the spring of 1857, Father Wolf had a stroke from which he recovered in the course of summer, so that he could even take a walk in the garden. In October, he had another stroke, and now the end was approaching fast. And on October 31st, he passed away peacefully at the age of 78. The news of the death of Father Wolf brought deep sorrow, especially among the older nuns who had known Monpere. He was all fondly called always Monpere in French, that is, my father or my dad. At the funeral mass, 1,200 people received communion, and an endless procession of priests, seminarians, parishioners, and strangers went to the church. Even his provincial who came from Utrecht could not find a way to enter inside. By his missions, retreats, instructions, his writings, his personal guidance, and his spiritual influence reached a great many people and continued long after his death. You can see Sisters Valsa and Anita and two others, Mary, they are standing. That is the, after the remains have been removed to Hayswick, there is still a monument there for the, of the Father Wolf grave. So far now we could say this is up to the Father Wolf's sanctity and his spirituality and his greatness as a spiritual person. Now we get into the third phase. Mother Clara resigned, who had been suffering from chronic and violent headache. She chose to go to Kulumbak as Father Wolf was there. Her health did not improve, and she died in 1880 at the age of 74 after governing the congregation for 16 years. She had managed to keep the spirit of the congregation such as Father Wolf had desired. The Chronicle praises her as an excellent religious who looked for support and strength in prayer to God. Mother Adriana was appointed as in charge. Mother Adriana Pipers. On 11th November 1856, Mother Adriana was elected as Superior General. When the result of the election reached, who was just then ill in bed, she was silent for a moment and then replied, "Lord, if I can be of any service to your work, I do not refuse it, even if it were for 20 years. These words were prophetic. For about 20 years, she bore the burden of government. In the year 1840, when she took her vows, she was elected as first assistant to the Superior General, and the training of the novices was entrusted to her. Besides the firmness which characterized her government, she was always tactful and obliging." Here we may say about her Mother Adriana a little bit. Earlier, she had entered the congregation with her sister. But then Mother Mathia was not somehow keen on sending her away, and so she was sent away. So when Mother Mathia left the congregation, she came back and again joined the congregation. Her first care was to call the assistants to the mother house. With the exception of the first assistant, all the rest were superiors of branch convents. They were replaced by other sisters, and this was a wise measure. With kind cheerfulness, showing nothing of her inner struggle, Mother Adriana continued the work imposed on her. She considered herself a tool in the hand of God to promote the education of the youth wherever possible. The sisters did their work faithfully. The lay people gave their moral and financial help, and God blessed them, joined their efforts. The first years of Mother Adriana were characterized by some important facts. In 1857, the first edition of special rules appeared, to which Dean Wilmer wished an article to be introduced, honoring forever Monsignor Swison as the second founder, coming next to the founder, Father Matthias Wolf. The feasts of St. Matthias and St. John the Baptist were from now onwards to be celebrated in the same way. I will come into the education about 1857. The Education Act of 1857 came into being with many difficulties, but no real freedom for education. Deeply disappointed, Mr. John Van Nispen decided to found a Catholic school in Sevenaar and invited the James sisters. Mr. John Van Nispen was a parliamentarian. On 8th December 1857, the convent with the chapel and the school were solemnly blessed and placed under the protection of the Immaculate Conception, encouraging the sisters' emancipatory rights. In the beginning, there will be crosses, as it ought to be, and I should be sorry if they were not. For in the cross, and in the cross only, is bliss. Another convent in Millingen in 1859 on the German frontier was established. The German girls were admitted to the boarding, and the result was that many German girls entered the congregation. So the great plans. A fact of great importance for the future was that the purchase of the old Kaiserhof, that is old imperial yard at Delbos. It was a large hotel situated on the spot where the schools of postal start stand. The purchase money, the cost of transport and other necessary expenses together with the cost of alterations required a considerable sum. The congregation was poor, but generous friends helped. Mother Adrienne was very pleased with the purchase and showed this repeatedly in her letters to Father Wolf, where in 1857, the sisters established themselves in Postal Stadt. They were asked to teach in the school which was already there from 1842. There were new foundations, namely Flyman, Waspik, Boxtel, Rotterdam, Berlikum, etc. So then we had to get into other works of mercy. Transfer of mother house to postal start in Den Bosch. The result was that in accordance with the Monsignor Schweitzer and President Goethe, the final decision fell on June 2, 1863, to remove the mother house to postal start in Den Bosch. As a good financier, he helped the congregation to lay up and invest a small capital. Gradually, they began to get over the financial difficulties. In March 1865, another house was bought in Kapuscheiner Port, that is Kapuscheiner's gate, with much difficulty. In 1862, Monsignor Schweitzer declared that it would be advantageous for the sisters besides education to consider other works of charity. Accordingly, on 1st July, while the congregation increased in new foundations, Mother Superior and her council were burdened with heavy cares. Unless the financial situation is improved, they decided in 1860 not to open new foundations. Nijmegen especially was a source of great anxiety. The novitiate remained in the mother house in Egelin. It was now seriously considered to move mother house to Den Bosch. The result was that in accordance with Monsignor and Schweitzer and President Kuten, the final decision fell on. So in March 1865, another house was bought in Kapuscheiner Port. An offer came from Monsignor Schweitzer to open the house in Helmonde, which in 1865 was realized. The next was in Boxmeer, where the Carmelite fathers owned a convent from 1653 and a school from 1658. In those years, the congregation was besieged with requests. From 1862 to 1867, 12 foundations were asked in all parts of the country, north, south, east, and west. We can imagine the fame of the JMJ. The requests were often urgent, clearly pointing to the need of good education and also showing the reputation our schools had gained throughout the country. In Rotterdam, they asked for sisters to nurse incurables. The congregation came into contact with the Brother of Islam, slot makers of the Society of Jesus, an able architect. the designer and the builder of the big Jesuit monastery, Marienthal at Grafe. There were, of course, financial problems, but in the years intervening, the sisters saved some money. The foundation was laid in the garden on the spring of 1868, and in 1869, the big mother house was finished. A school was built for girls in Bärhofstraat. The new mother house was officially opened on 21st June 1871 and placed under the protection of St. Ignatius. On the same day, the novices moved from Engelen, and on the 28th, the professed sisters moved into the mother house. It was a great event in the history of the congregation. Everyone was imbued with a spirit of thankfulness. The names of Monsignor Swison and Monsignor Keuten were gratefully mentioned. The removal of the mother house and the renovation to Den Bosch gave the congregation a former foothold for its further development. The congregation could now prepare for its golden jubilee. At the end of the survey of the work in 1872, shows that in elementary school there were 5,531 children, of whom 2,121 were poor and less intelligent. The boarders were 289. Besides, before and after school hours, catechism was taught, and in the Sunday schools, 1,989 children. The schools in the mother house had a strength of 749 pupils. Principles of governance. Mother Adriana, who was always mindful of maintaining discipline everywhere, drew a series of regulations for the various offices. She devoted particular care to the training of the superiors. The principal chapters of a book in French on governing religious communities by Father Valle S.J. was translated, and a handbook was written for superiors with a preface that it was always the wish of Reverend Father Will that the congregation should be governed according to the spirit of the Society of Jesus. These were printed and distributed to the communities. A French book on the knowledge and love of the Most Sacred Heart was translated into Dutch and was introduced in 1874. Also, the book entitled Meditations of the Most Sacred Heart was used in preparation for the feast for the first Fridays and some others on the most pure heart of Mary. Consecration. I think there's something is missing. In the autumn of 1874, Mother Adriana was re-elected with the assistance of Seraphine Fullers, a woman endowed with many gifts. After the election of Mother Adriana, serious plans were made to start a training college in Den Bosch to prepare the future teachers. From 1884 to 1898, out of 160 people, 61 entered the society, a big harvest of vocations. In December, Mother Adriana fell ill, seriously ill, and ardently looked forward to the union with her God. Let me go to heaven. I do not pray for my recovery, but let me die and go to heaven. On the night of 16th September, she passed away peacefully. Consecration to Sacred Heart of Jesus. To find great stimulus for the sisters in their apostolic works, Mother Adriana solemnly consecrated the whole congregation on the Feast of Sacred Heart of Jesus in 1873. In all communities, it was made on the same day. 2 years later, Pope Pius IX consecrated the whole world to the Sacred Heart of Jesus. Every year, this consecration was to be renewed in the congregation. So, a new central government on October 15, 1875, a new central government was elected with Mother Seraphine Fullers as the superior general. So this is the work of development by Mother Adriana. The above narration has been abridged and concised from Seed Grows Up, Volume 1. All the developments for the growth and expansion of the society did not go without difficulties and challenges, especially the finances and civil authorities. The great help Monsignor Swison and of the Jesuits in all endeavors needs worth mentioning. Their life of prayer, simplicity, their many sacrifices, and utter dependence on the providence of God paid rich dividends in the mission of Christ. Thanks to Father Wolf, who envisioned the Society JMJ to do great things for God and the humanity. May all of us imbibe His spirituality as we pray with much devotion and meaningfully and be true to what we pray. Together we pray, change me to thyself, dear Lord, that I may live in thee and for thee alone. May my happiness consist in fulfilling thy holy will. Amen. Thank you, sisters.